time five, not including myself, is in no specific order. I'd say Muhammad Ali. I'd say Larry Holmes. I'd say Lennox Lewis. I'd say Joe Lewis. And who else would I put in that five? I'd probably put Rocky Marciano in there as well, because he was unbeaten 49-0.
Well, I was talking a few days ago about Marciano. You know, the difference in weight of today's heavyweights and the pre-WBC era, Marciano was like 190, 195 pounds, 185 pounds.
And yeah.
He could punch. He could be a champion in today's boxing.
Yeah, he could be a champion in the light heavyweight division and the cruiserweight division, because that's the weight of him. Like the weight today, like my weight for my last fight was 272 pounds.
Yeah.
And 6'9" tall and very athletic. You know, even Wilder's 6'7" and 232. Joshua's 6'6" and 242. You know, the guys of today are like dinosaurs compared to the old-time greats from the past. But then again, Mauricio, time evolves, everybody gets bigger and stronger and faster.
Absolutely.
This is part of the new style of new technologies, nutrition. Now fighters have strength and conditioning coach and even a psychologist. And, you know, a lot of things are coming into play, you know, nutrition.
So yes.
Not a different sport, but a different era. I don't know if, do you believe the boxers are getting stronger with all this development?
I believe everything evolves. Like if you look at the world's fastest man from 10 years ago, compared to Usain Bolt today, it's a hell of a difference, like really quicker. If you look at the world's fastest car from 20 years ago and look at the world's fastest car today, everything's got bigger and faster. If you look at a big truck from 20 years ago and one from today, they're all bigger and faster. But like you said there, Pepe, you touched on something really good. You said nutritionist, strength and conditionist, psychologist, some of these guys are having. But back in the day, 30, 50, 100 years ago, they never even had this sort of stuff. Some of them didn't even eat food. There's a famous fighter called a Cinderella man, Jimmy Braddock. He didn't eat for 3 days before he fought Max Baer for the World Heavyweight Championship. So, you know, we're very privileged to live in this era and to be able to have all the nutritionists, the strength conditioning work, not have to go to a full-time laboring job and be a full-time professionals and take it very, very serious and very professional. The guys back in the day, I often heard stories of fighters having brandies in between rounds and stuff.
Absolutely. Yeah. We have quite stories about some fighters after making the weight. You know, the weight in those days was the day of the fight. They would make the weight and they would go and have brandy and rum to get warm up for the fight.
I'll tell you guys something, that you probably don't know. When I was boxing Deontay Wilder in Los Angeles in 2018, it was the night before the fight. I had this urge to go downstairs and have a beer. So I thought, you know what? I'm fighting for the heavyweight championship of the world. My body's telling me I want a beer. I'm going to go downstairs and have one. Yeah. So I calls up my buddy who organizes things for me, Tim. And I says, Tim, meet me downstairs in 5 minutes at the bar. He said, what? I said, meet me downstairs in 5 minutes. So I go downstairs and I get two beers, one for me, one for my buddy, Tim. And he says, what are you doing? You're fighting for the heavyweight championship of the world in the morning, tomorrow night. And I was like, listen, the old-time greats, they used to have brandies and they used to get absolutely sackless drunk before championship fights. So I thought, if I can't have a beer, I'll be right. So I ended up having a beer and I felt good, went to bed, got an early night, but I felt great the next day and I put up a good fight.
That's a good one. That's a good story. Were there people in the bar?
Yeah, there were people in the bar and they were like, hey, champ, what's happening? Can I buy you a drink? And I was like, no, thank you. I'm fighting in the morning for the championship of the world tomorrow evening, sorry.
You didn't know how to wrestle any of them?
Yeah.
That's a classic.
Yeah, there was a lot of people in the bar, so you can imagine how hectic it was. And for them all to see me walking down, having a beer at the bar, it was like, wow, this guy's crazy.
You're unique. You're a character.
Yes.
And, tell us about your life in general, before boxing, the gypsy thing, the gypsy lifestyle, your grandparents, your parents. What can you...
Yes. Oh, well, what I am is the gypsy king. The gypsy lifestyle and race goes back to the first century. Goes back 1,000 years. And they travel throughout the world. There's gypsies in every single country in the world. That's why I have a very, very, very big following, whichever country I go to. If I boxed in Jamaica, or if I boxed in Spain or Italy or Mexico, anywhere, then there'd be gypsies in that country and they'd come to support me. That's my granny and grandfather right there. There are nomadic people. The gypsies, there are nomadic people. They like to travel around. They used to travel around in horse-drawn carts and wagons, like you used to see on the old cowboy and Indian pictures, films, sort of similar to like that. And yeah, they the lifestyle is, though, it's always been about fighting. We've always been oppressed people. We suffered racism, even today. Even as a heavyweight champion of the world, I suffer with racism on a daily basis. And people would look at me and say, well, you're a white guy. How can you suffer racism? Well, the racism towards gypsies is, it seems to be the only acceptable form of racism throughout the world. And nobody does anything. So, yeah, we keep ourselves to ourselves. We're hardworking people, God-fearing people. But we love to fight. You know, I suppose we're similar to Mexican people. God-fearing, honorable, love to fight. And we've been fighting all our lives. Even from a little boy, I was brought up around boxing, fighting. My dad was a fighter, uncles, grandparents, everybody boxed or fought. So it's bred in us automatically. All the boys, the males throughout the community and all that, they all can box. And a lot of them have won national championships in many different countries, even in America, in England, everywhere. So we grow up around boxing. You know, in England, the national sport is soccer. But with the gypsies, we grow up fighting. If you go to, like, the national championships for all the ages, in every category, say there's 11 or 12 different weight categories, then 9 or 10 of them will be travelers in the final.
Wow.
So, but what happens with them, usually, 80% of the time, they get to 16 years old, 17, to when they get a bit older, and then they get married. They get married young, and they have to provide for their wife, and then they have children young. And before they know it, they're 20 years old, and they've got 3 kids.
And the way you describe the similarity with the Mexican people, Mexicans... through the Aztecs, the Mayans, the way the culture came about, they were fighters, they were warriors.
Yes.
And I could see something special shining in your eyes when you got the Mayan belt.
Yes, I absolutely loved it. I got that Mayan belt and I'm gonna show you because I have many, many, many belts, but at the top of my list, at the top of my display cabinet, how do I turn this camera around? Zooming out. There we go. At the top, there's all the other belts. There's the Ring Magazine belt. And there's my Mayan belt right at the top. Look, if you look, there's all the other belts in the cabinet, every single belt in boxing. But there's my green Mayan belt. Right at the top where she belongs.
I love it. I love it.
So, yes, it's very special to me. And when I heard that I was going to be fighting for the WBC Mayan belt, I thought it was a great honor because I became the first non-Mexican person to fight for this prestigious belt. And I've even got the nickname El Rey Gitanos.
Yes.
And I've got it on my phone. And it, on my phone, it's my phone name. but I have a Mexican coach, Jorge Capitella, in Las Vegas as well. And I have quite a few Mexican friends in Las Vegas, in and around Vegas.
Yes.
That,
but the, you know, the thing about fighting is also why you fight. You know, a lot of people just fight for money, just for fame. You fight also with a mission, with a purpose, not specifically in material. You have like a more of a, also a spiritual vision
in
the world.
Yes, Pepe. I, you know, as a heavyweight champion of the world, I've become a two-time heavyweight champion, lineal champion. I've won every belt. I've made quite a bit of money out of boxing. But, you know, some fighters, they get a few dollars and they just go crazy. They buy all shiny things and whatever. And by the time they look around, they've spent all the money and they're back to where they started. But for me, the assets, material assets, is not what it's about for me. I live in a normal house. I drive a normal car. Me and my wife and kids, we do normal life. And that's how I like to keep it grounded. Why I box now? In the beginning, it was about being heavyweight champion of the world. And nothing was ever going to stop me from becoming the heavyweight champion of the world. And then I beat Klitschko and won all the belts, become the unified champion. But when I made the return in 2018, it was going to be about something different for me. It was going to be about helping people who were suffering with mental health problems. It was going to be about showing the world that anything is possible. Because I came back from just over 400 pounds to get back to fighting fit again within about 8 months' time, and I was in the ring again fighting. And I was so down, I was suicidal, I was depressed on a daily basis. I didn't want to live anymore. I suffered with bipolar and anxiety, depression. And I wanted to show more than anything that anything is possible, because people told me it was impossible to come back. They told me that I'd never box again. They told me I was too fat, I'd gone too far. And I wanted to prove to the world that with the right mindset and dedication, anything's possible. Even if you're reaching for the stars, you will get there eventually. You might need a rocket ship to get to the stars. Yeah. But eventually, if you aim high enough, you're going to hit one. And that's what I'm doing in this time, you know. I box and I fight for people, not just for money and fame and glory, because it's all quite pointless, because this is a short life. And it's about, for me, it's about leaving a mark and a legacy and helping people around me today. And being a good person and inspiring and helping others around the world who are suffering, who are oppressed, who are down, who do need a helping hand. And maybe when I keep talking about it all the time and doing interviews and videos about mental health and stuff like that, then maybe just one person might see it and think, you know what, I'm going to change my life today because I saw that guy do it. And I know it's possible. And that's what I aim for. I aim to help others who are down and who don't think there's a way back. And, you know, I'm like a shining light to people around the world who are suffering with mental health problems, because there's always a way out and there's always a way back to where you want to go. You just got to find the right path to the promised land.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, indirectly, without knowing it, you have saved Jorge Capetillo, for example. His gym was in the verge of having extreme problems, and you go in and do an exhibition and you do an event to save his gym. And now he's in your corner. Now he's in the corner of the heavyweight champion of the world. So you are always looking on ways to do, to touch people and change their lives directly and indirectly. You must feel very, very profoundly proud of yourself.
You know what? I love to help other people. I'm a God-fearing man, and I like to do good things to others. I'd rather do good things to people than do bad things to them. You know, there's a lot of badness goes on in this world, and I don't need to add to it. You know, we've all had our problems, and God knows I've had many problems in myself, and I probably will continue to have problems. But the thing is, it's about doing good things and trying to help other people as best as we can. You know, and even in these big fights, big world championship fights, I'm helping people because they're getting entertained in these big fights. They're tuning in to watch them. People from all hours in the morning. When I box in Las Vegas, it's 5 a.m. in the morning here in the UK. And everyone stays up to watch and around the world. So, you know, I just hope that I can be good for the sport. I hope I can breathe life back into it as I've done over the last few years and give it a real buzz again, the heavyweight division, because when Klitschko's had the belts, no disrespect to the guys, they were great champions, but there wasn't a real buzz around the heavyweight division. It was classed as boring, and it was classed as, like, the heavyweight championship of the world needs to be in the West. That's for sure. It needs to be in, like, North America or the UK or somewhere like that. When it's in Europe, people, like the American people, the Mexican people, the British, the Irish, they don't sort of, it doesn't mean as much to them. It also almost devalues the heavyweight championship of the world. And now that it was in America with Deontay Wilder, he's back in the UK with me and you got Andy Joshua, it seems to be that the heavyweight division is thriving back to the late 80s and 90s when you had like Evander Holyfield, Mike Tyson, Larry Holmes, Lennox Lewis, back to those days. And that's what I hope to take it back to the glory days of heavyweight boxing. And I've proved that I'm willing to step up to the plate and give the fans the fights they want to see. Because as we all know that Wilder was trying to fight Anthony Joshua for 2 years and there was a lot of money on the table, $80 million to be precise, and they turned it down. And I was here, I was 400 pounds plus, and I was thinking to myself, I need to come back and I need to fight Deontay Wilder, almost to defend my country type of thing, because a lot in the boxing game, they were saying, oh, the British heavyweights, they're all cowards and whatever. And I'm sitting here thinking, I've been retired for nearly 3 years, 400 pounds, I'm going to make a comeback and I'm going to knock Wilder out. Within 6 months, I was back in the ring. I'm back fighting Deontay Wilder for the first fight. And I proved that, like I said before to Pepe, I proved that with the right mindset, anything is possible. And I wasn't ready at the time for that first Wilder fight. I sort of jumped into it hasty. But I knew then that when he couldn't beat me, when he couldn't do anything with me then, I outboxed him all the way. I knew then, like, when I'm match fit and ready, I have a couple more fights, he would not live with me. And that proved to be the fact. I absolutely annihilated him.
Yeah. Do you recall in your darkest hour, in your lowest moment, what ignited, what said, okay, enough is enough, I'm going to get out from this and change my life?
Well, I'll tell you what happened. Yeah, there was a specific turning point. There was a couple, actually. There was two. I'll start with the first one. I was in a high-powered car, Ferrari, to be precise. And this day, I was very down and depressed, and I was going to kill myself. I decided I was going to commit suicide by smashing this car into a bridge. And I picked the bridge out, and I knew where I was going to go. It was a familiar road to me. And I got the car up to a very high speed and I was aiming towards this motorway bridge, highway bridge. And I got within maybe 100 feet of the bridge, 200 feet. And something told me, I almost heard a voice. Maybe I did hear a voice. I'm not saying I didn't, but I heard it as clear as we're talking now. And it said to me, it said, Tyson, do not do this. You're going to destroy your family's lives. Your kids are going to grow up with no father. You're going to make things very, very difficult. And I immediately slammed on the brakes and pulled the car over. And people say, before you die, you see your life flash in front of you. I didn't see no life flash in front of me. All I could think about was leaving the kids with no father and having them to grow up without me. So I pulled the car over and I could feel my heart beating out my chest. And I could feel tears coming down my face. At the time, I didn't know this was happening. I was all in erratic mood. And I thought to myself, this is the first time I need to get help, because I'd suffered with anxiety and depression from being a young boy, but never was diagnosed, never went to see a doctor until I got to 28 years old. So I went to see the doctor, and at first I didn't think the doctor thing was going to be for me. I wasn't convinced about it. And I went to see this doctor and I spoke to him. And I told him about what was going on and all that. And he told me that I wasn't the only person in the world who had these problems. Because at the time, when you're not educated on this matter, which I wasn't, I never had a clue about it. I just knew that I would feel down and I feel bad all the time, ill. And I didn't want to live. And he said, you need medication. You need help. And I was like, I don't want any medication, because my grandfather, he had medication and he never got off it. He was on it his whole life. He was addicted to medication. These antidepressant drugs or whatever they were. So I didn't want to take the medication. I was adamant that I could do it through training and a healthy lifestyle. And he said, I'm telling you, you're going to struggle without medication. I was like, no, I'm going to come and see you and speak to you once or twice a week. And I'm going to do this through healthy eating and diet. And I believe it was 2017, Halloween night. I went out, was dressed up as a skeleton, a glow-in-the-dark skeleton suit. And I was in a bar, and I was feeling very down. And it was a moment of madness, and I was having a beer. And I thought to myself, I looked around me and I could see all young people at the beginning of their lives. And I thought to myself, what are you doing here? Go home right now. And I put the beer down and I left immediately. And I come home around about 8 p.m. And Paris would usually expect me not to come home at all, or come home at 5 in the morning at that time. So she said, who's that? I said, it's me. I'm going upstairs. And I went upstairs, I took the suit off, and I got down on my knees. I was in my underpants. And I got down on my knees at 28 stone in weight, 400 pounds. I was heart attack material. And I was crying out to God to help me, because I knew I couldn't do it on my own. I knew that it wasn't possible anymore. Unless I wanted to get addicted to these drugs, these antidepressant drugs and more medication, I knew I couldn't do it on my own. So I remember reading George Foreman's autobiography. And I remember that there's a part in his book where he talks about he had a nephew who was very ill, and he got on his knees and he begged God to help him. And he was down there for a while. And I thought, he worked for George. It's going to work for me. So I got on my knees and I was crying out to God on my knees. And it felt like I was down there for an hour, but maybe I was down there for like 20 minutes or something. And I poured my heart out. Everything I wanted to say, everything I had on my chest, I let it all out in the room. I was in a dark room on my own. If ever someone had seen me, they'd think this guy's crazy, put him in an institute. And I got up off the floor. Even though I was 400 pounds, I felt like a welterweight. I felt like I had the weight of the world on my shoulders when I went down. But when I got back up, I was elevated. I was back. And I said to Paris, I called out to my wife and I said, Paris. She said, what? I said, tomorrow morning, I start the regain mission. I'll become a heavyweight champion of the world again. But she'd been used to me saying this. I was the boy who cried wolf. Every time I got drunk and had a couple of beers, I'd be shadowboxing in the living room saying, I'm going to be an heavyweight champion of the world again. So she never took it serious. But this one night, I'd not had anything to drink. I was sober as a judge. And I meant it with conviction. And she believed me. And the next day, I started the regain mission to become heavyweight champion of the world again. And I phoned up a trainer and I said, I'm ready to train now. And I phoned up Frank Warren. I said, I'm ready to make a comeback, Frank. He goes, yeah. He said, we'll power a comeback. Return of the Mac. And then that day I got my sweatsuit on and I went, I intended to jog 1 mile, just one. And I didn't get half a mile without stopping. And I stopped and I walked. And as I was walking, I was looking on Instagram at some videos and I saw a video that Deontay Wilder had done, and he said that he could knock out Mike Tyson in one round in his heyday. And I thought, this is disrespectful, because Mike Tyson's 50 odd years old and Deontay Wilder's a young champion in his era. And I thought, you know what, for that one comment, I'm going to come back and I'm going to knock you out. And he also said some stuff about me as well. He said, oh, he's fat and he'll never make a comeback, he's too far gone. So I owe Deontay Wilder for actually bringing me back and giving me more inspiration to return, as well as God. And I never stopped. And from this day to that day, I've never stopped training. I've trained every single day since the 1st of November 2017.
1st of November, after Halloween, of course.
Yes.
Do you believe in omens and premonitions and things like that?
It depends what you mean and what type of omens and premonitions.
Let me tell you why.
Go on.
Before the fight, in a press conference, I don't know if you remember that you were in the middle of the stage.
So yeah.
Yelling and everybody was around and blah, 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 blah. All of a sudden, a pigeon came flying very close.
True, yes.
And then it went to the stands over there on your side. So for me, taking skills, taking favoritism, taking everything out of the question, the dove went to your side. For me, that was an omen. That was a premonition that you were going to win the fight. You know, in my crazy world, that's how it worked. That's how I said, okay, that's it. He's going to win.
You know, the world works in mysterious ways. And I wouldn't say that I don't believe in things like that, because I do. You know, us gypsies, we believe in stuff like that. We believe that animals can bring warning signs and stuff, especially birds.
Yeah.
It's quite fitting that you say the dove, because, like, we believe that birds carry messages of warning.
For sure.
I've had a few birds tell me a few different things. It sounds crazy. But we believe that if a bird flies in a building where you are, then it's a sign that something bad's going to happen or something good's going to happen to the individual it happens to. Mm-hmm. Like you say, it flew right past me. I literally moved out of the way of it. It got that close to me. And since then, for a long time, you know, wild birds have been flying right next to me and sitting down on the floor. I kid you not. I kid you not. I've even got a picture that I'll send to your phone number in a minute. And I'm going to show you. I was sat on my balcony outside and a little tiny bird, a wild bird, it flew within 3 feet away from me. And they never come that close. Mm-hmm. And I'm having big birds, crows and pigeons and everything fly right near me. So maybe there's something in it. I do not know.
It's just a blessing. You know, you can't break your head trying to figure out what the meaning is. Enjoy something special happening in that moment. You know, I mean, for many people,